Understand that God has great destiny planned for your life. But in order to get to you, you must go through. I was on the verge of giving up. I went into 3 weeks of fasting and prayer, asking the Lord to help me understand what's going on in my life. While on my knees, crying out to God, these words prophetically came out of my mouth.
In spite of it all, glory to God. Amen. We are so honored to be in the presence of God today. We thank the Lord for just being here today and tonight. And we're believing God for an awesome time in the Holy Ghost tonight. Amen. We're believing God that somebody will be healed, somebody will be delivered, somebody will be touched by the power of the living God tonight. And we just ask you to bring your heart. Let's begin to be, we may be few in number, but let's begin to become a family tonight. And let's come and worship God together in one. The Bible says where there is unity, there is what? Strength. Let's get with one mind. The Bible says when they was all up in the room, in the upper room, they came with one mind and with what? One accord. Hallelujah. And let's come with one mind tonight and let's get with one accord. Praise the Lord. Is that all right? Come on, let's begin to lift our hands before the Lord. Father, we glorify you, God. God, we magnify you, God. We thank you that you're an awesome God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And I'm asking you that you just lose yourself tonight. This is about him. This is about the Spirit of God. This is about him getting the glory, not about us. Put ourselves aside. This is not about us tonight. Glory to God. Father, we declare that there is none like you. You and all the earth, oh God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, God. God, we thank you, Lord God. We thank you. I worship you.
No!
you've been so good to us.
So good.
So good. So good. So I worship you. I magnify you.
Yes.
I lift your name on high.
Oh, yes.
Because you are worthy,
worthy
to be praised.
Yes.
So I glorify you. I magnify your name. Now, why don't y'all just stand on your feet real quick? Stand on your feet. Because I truly believe that God is already in here. So we're going to magnify him. We're going to give him all out of all. We're going to glorify him. We're going to give him honor. We're going to give him praise. Because he is truly worthy of the praise. So I ask y'all to please bow your heads real quick, please. Oh, Father God, Jesus. First of all, we want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you for waking us this morning. We thank you for starting us on our way, Lord. We thank you for just being who you are. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise because we know we couldn't do it without you. Lord, we thank you for this conference. Oh, Father God, Jesus, Lord, bless it right now in the name of Jesus. Not only bless each and every last one that's here right now, Lord. Lord, we just ask that you would please go with us, oh, Father God, Jesus. Go with us wherever we go, Father God Jesus, because we know it's not about us, but it's all about you. It's all about giving you praise and hope and giving you honor. So we magnify your name right now, Father God Jesus. Bless your name right now in the name. Bless this house. Bless this church right now. Bless the speaker that's going to speak your word, oh Father God Jesus. So we magnify you. We give you honor. We give you glory. We give you praise right now because you are so worthy. Lord, you didn't have to do it, but you did, oh Father God Jesus. You kept us when we didn't want to be kept, oh Father God Jesus. So we magnify you. We glorify you right now. We say hallelujah. Thank you for keeping our children, oh God. The Lord, thank you for keeping them from danger, seen and unseen, God. Thank you for keeping us, oh Father God Jesus. We thank you, oh God. Thank you for the blessing we ask in your precious Son, Jesus. We pray, amen, amen, and amen. I'm going to read, if you all have your Bibles, can you all turn with me to Romans, the 8th chapter?
Come on!
It's my chapter.
Romans, the 8th chapter. When I was first asked to do this, and you know, this scripture came to my spirit because of all of the things that's going on around the tornadoes and you know, just so many things, people getting killed. You know, people losing their jobs. You know, just so many things that's happening. And in my spirit, it told me to go to Romans 8:28. And the word says, and we know.
We know. Come on now. Come on, go ahead and walk in now.
And we know all things.
All.
All things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. We all have a purpose. So now that we know that we have a purpose, you got to remember that all things are working for your good. So I just want to encourage y'all that to know that it's working no matter what you're going through, no matter what your situation is. You got to remember that all things, even the bad things, is working together for your good. No matter what it is, it's working together for your good. Why? Because you are called. You are called according to what? His purpose. So I just want to leave that in y'all's spirit. I don't know about y'all, but I'm excited. So I'm just gonna let God have his way with me. I'm just sorry. I've been through too much, and I've been through too much hell going through this week right here to get to this point to sit on God right now. I can't sit on him right now. I gotta lift my hands and give him honor. I gotta lift my hands and give him glory. Because what? All things are working together for what? My good. So you might as well give him praise right now. You might as well give him honor right now. Why? Because all things are working. What? To our good, right? So let's give him honor right now. Let's give him glory right now. Because he deserves it. Hallelujah.
behind us. Amen. Somebody, amen, can say everything I went through today. Amen. God deserves a hallelujah. Amen. Amen. He is worthy of all of our praise. And we can only wrap our minds around the fact that he's worthy of all of our praise. Amen. Then the praise and worship leader wouldn't have to pump us.
That's right.
Amen. Then the music wouldn't have to be in our key, but we would realize that God is worthy of our praise. Amen. So we don't make any noise at all. We can just lift our hands. Amen. And worship the Lord. Amen. Because he's worthy of all of our praise. Amen. Amen. Do I have anybody today that realizes that God is worthy?
Come on, y'all.
We gotta go there. God is worthy. 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 God, you're worthy. 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 You might as well get with me. You're worthy. You're worthy. You're worthy. You're worthy. God, you're worthy. You're worthy. God. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, worship
you. We worship your holiness. Yes, yes. We adore you. We adore you. We kneel down. Kneel down. Amen. Then the women would follow in. Amen. And then our families would follow in. But amen, we've got to learn how. how to set the atmosphere for worship, amen. Amen. So, amen, I'm going to ask, amen, you all, amen, help me, amen, with this song, amen, amen.
Great and mighty is our God. Great and mighty is our God. Come on and help me say, great, great and mighty is our God. Great and mighty is our God.
Come on, do that again, do it again. Say,
great and mighty is our God. Yes, God.
How mighty
is thy God?
because there was no one there to play anyways. Amen, amen, amen. We were lucky if there was a big drum and a tap drum kind of thing. And, amen, amen. We used to, amen, sing songs. Amen. But sing songs, amen, sometimes the song, amen, Sister Sorrell went on 5 or 10 minutes, seemed like it. Amen. Then when one got done singing, when that one got tired, she passed it to the other one and they sang it. And then when they got, y'all know what I'm talking about. It. Amen. And so, amen, those are the songs, amen, when I'm going through, amen, brother. Amen. I find myself, when I have weeks like I had this week, I find myself singing some of them songs that, amen, that does something. I don't need anybody else to help me sing those songs. I don't need a keyboard player. I don't need an organ. I don't need drums. I can hear it in myself. Come on, y'all. I can just tap my feet myself. And then before I know it, amen, I'll just stop singing. I'm just clapping my hands. And those are the kind of things I'm talking about. The song said something real simple. It said, "Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't no. Come on, y'all. Do me like, oh, can't nobody do me like Jesus. Oh, can't nobody. Oh, can't nobody.
I can't find nobody. I can't find nobody. I look right now, we just truly having a great men's conference. Every night it's getting better and better. Even this morning was just awesome. And we just can't get any better than this. And we just want you to just take off your shoes, relax yourself, and just enjoy yourself, and let the hair down, whatever you need to do. But just give it all you got tonight and just enjoy yourself. That's all we ask you to do. We just ask you to just, whatever it takes to make you feel good, just enjoy yourself tonight. So we're just going to lift up the name of Jesus, and we're just all going to have a tremendous time in the name of Jesus. Just say amen, everybody. Hallelujah. Welcome once, welcome twice.
All right. It's over now.
Hallelujah.
My God.
And I began to understand that the grace of God is God's undeserved favor, his power. And it takes the struggle. It takes the struggle out of things. When we begin to receive the abundance of grace, the Bible says in Romans the 5th chapter and the 17th, to those that receive this abundance of grace and this free gift of, and this gift of righteousness, they shall reign.
Yes,
we are supposed to reign through the grace of God. Yes. It takes the struggle out of things. Glory to God. And you begin to depend on the grace and begin to receive. We need to get more people to receive the grace of God today. Because Jesus has paid it all. You don't have to stay there. You don't have to stay where you are. You don't have to stay in your struggle. Glory to God. But I'm telling you, people of God, when I begin to learn to receive the grace of God, my life became easier. Because I realized that Jesus has done the work. Anybody realize that Jesus has already done the work? It's our job. The Bible says to labor to enter into the rest of God. It's for us to labor in God's word, to believe and take the word of God and trust the word of God and let the word do the what?
Amen.
Let the word do the work. And we can get people to trust and receive the grace of God. The storm is over. Come on, somebody declare for me that my storm. Look, I don't care if hell is breaking loose in your life right now. You declare that my storm.
My storm.
As a man is in his heart, what?
So is he.
Glory to God. That's power. The power comes when you believe in the midst of your storm. Anybody can dance and shout in church while everything looks good. But then when you get home, when everything's looking crazy, can you speak the word of God and stand and rest on it?
I just want to share something briefly before I sing something that has happened to me in the past week and something that God has placed upon my heart. Well, long story short, last week I was out in Valdosta, Georgia, back home, and I hadn't been there in like a year and a half, and I had walked into my grandma's house, and the only thing I heard was, "Here come Crip." Because I'm walking in here with crutches. And I began to laugh about it. And I would go around the town, and I went to my old high school, and I was sitting there and I walked through, and everybody just was beginning to remind me of how bad I was, or the things that I had done, or the things that I had used to get into. And they couldn't tell, like, that I had completely reformed myself, like completely changed myself, like I was so serious about God now compared to what I was back then. I would go to church. I'm a preacher's grandkid. I would go to church. But it's nothing like being serious about God. It's nothing about having a relationship with God. It's nothing like it. And so I began to sit down, and I was thinking to myself, I was like, why could everybody see, that I'm crippled? Everybody sees that I was what I was. Everybody seen me for the bad that I had done because of what I had left upon them. But they never knew the person that I was today. They never seen it. They began to lose sight of the person that was standing in front of them, and they seen the person that was standing in front of them. But I had to trust inside myself and know that God sees me for who I am. I had to trust and believe that God seen me for how good I could be in the things that I had to offer. If the people would have came up to me and said, I see you crippled, but I know you giving God some praise. I know you can bring somebody to God or something that you can do for the kingdom. I would have sat there and I would have took that with open arms. But I'm not going to take somebody saying that I'm crippled, me knowing what I have inside that I can use for God.
Come on now.
But what I knew is, he saw the best in me. When everyone else around me could only see the worst in me. See the worst in me. Oh. He saw the best in me. Oh, when everyone else around me could only see the worst in me. Yeah. Oh, I had to remember that He is mine. Done a lot of stuff that you ain't have no business doing. You have been a lot of places that you could have been easily mistaken as being a bad person. You have been doing or been around a wrong crowd. But I had to reevaluate myself and say, it's a lot of stuff they couldn't look at me and tell that I had been through. It's a lot of stuff they couldn't look at me and say, oh, well, you was there. Yeah, obviously you can look down and see that I did something and broke my ankle, but you can't see the hurt that I have been caused. You can't see the hurt that anybody has been caused. And I just begin to say, I don't look like what I've been through. Yeah. So I don't look like walk around town and you see them on their jobs and you see them being successful and you see them running a lot of stuff. You see pastors, you see ministers and everything. And you see them walking around and preaching the gospel. But you never know what they went through to get to where they're at. You never know. You can't never pinpoint a person and say, well, they had it easy all their life. You can't tell that. You can't. You can sit here and look up at me and say, oh, he had it easy. I didn't. I chose to do some things that my mom would have been completely against. I left my mom in the ninth grade and I went to stay with my dad. I thought I knew what was best for me. Little did I know. Little did I didn't know. But I'm grateful that I don't look like what I've been through. What I've been through.
scripture?
Everyone else around me can only see the words in me. Saw the best, the best, the best.
Tonight, God, Lord, let your word go forth with power, clarity, and anointing, God, that yokes will be destroyed, God, and lives will forever be changed by your word. And now, Lord, I ask you, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Oh, Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And let the church say amen and amen and amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We want to go right into the Word of God. We don't want to prolong the time. Amen. Those of you that have your Bibles, amen, let us turn to Ephesians chapter 6. Amen. Starting from verse number 10. Ephesians chapter 6. Amen. Starting from verse number 10. Amen. If you got it, say amen. I'm going to give you a little time. Amen. Praise the Lord. I believe there's a word for someone in the house tonight. Amen. When I was kind of studying this particular, these particular verses from 10 to 18, amen, I kind of want to choose a subject here, praying men of war. Amen. Praying men of war. Amen. And we're going to start from verse number 10. Amen. It's going to be a little teaching tonight because a lot of stuff I had to jot down that God is putting in my heart. Amen. So we want to make sure that you get the word in your hearts. Amen.
Amen.
Start from verse number 10. It reads as, everybody got it? Say amen. I want to make sure everybody got it. Praise the Lord. And verse number 10, it reads as, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. The word in verse 10 says finally. The word finally means may be rendered from now on or henceforth. The spiritual battle Christians are engaged and exist from now on until the Lord's return. From now on until the Lord's end, there is all out war. So finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. The enemy would love for you to be weak in the Lord and not strong. Let me repeat that again. The enemy would love for you to be weak in the Lord and not strong in the Lord. Amen. Your strength comes from prayer. Your strength comes from the word of God. Your strength comes from, amen, praises your God up and down. Praising God, no matter what you're going through, whether up and down, you're still giving God praise.
Yeah.
Amen. It doesn't matter what you are facing in your life, amen, still give God praise.
Yeah.
Look at somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So he said, be strong in the Lord. Amen. In the power of His might. Look at your neighbor and say,
be strong in the Lord.
Let yourself constantly be strengthened by the Lord, more precisely by His mighty power. You can't be strong in the Lord if you're not consistent in the Lord. Let me repeat that again. You cannot be strong in the Lord if you are not consistent in the Lord.
Come on.
You can't have stuff. You can't just say, well, I want to
to go to church when I want to go to church, and then you skip a whole week or 2 weeks, or you skip days. No, you got to be consistent in the Lord.
Yes.
You can't say, well, I want to pray when I want to pray, and I'm going to pray this day and skip another day and skip a week. No, you got to be consistent in the Lord.
Yes.
You can't tithe when you want to tithe. You got to tithe when God say tithe. Amen, somebody.
Come on. Yes. Come on. Come on.
Thank you, Lord.
He said, put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Look at them and say, stand.
Stand.
Here, when he said, put on me, is imperative, denotes a sense of urgency, the minute, immediately action. Somebody said, put on.
Put on.
That means it is urgent that you put on the whole armor of God. Somebody say the whole armor of God.
The whole armor of God.
I ain't seen nobody say some armor. They say, I want you to put on the whole armor of God.
Yeah.
Nothing lacking, nothing missing. Complete. So he said, I want you to put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Stand here has a military overtones. This verse was used in classical Greek, meaning to resist the enemy and to hold a critical position in battle. Somebody say stand.
Stand.
The word wiles. The wiles of the devil mean the strategies, the schemes, the tactics, and the ways against the believer. So the devil is scheming and strategizing while you're in church. And while people play in church, he's strategizing. He is scheming. He is sending all kind of tactics. He is planning while some people play in church. While you're serious, he's still planning. He wants you to have a bad day when you wake up in the morning. While you're sleeping 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock in the morning, the adversary is just like sitting there planning how he's going to make your day bad. Planning how you're going to get you all upset. Planning how you're going to get you angry and mad with God. He is planning. He is strategizing how he's going to make your day bad.
Jesus.
Somebody say stand.
Stand.
Look at the name and say stand.
Stand.
I'm going to stand right here in the Lord and not be moved.
Come on.
And when I stand firm in God, nothing can move me.
Amen.
Doesn't matter what comes your way, you cannot be moved if you are standing, if you are firm, if you are abiding in the Lord. Amen. You cannot be moved because hell of high water. You cannot be moved if you are standing in the Lord.
Yes. Jesus.
Jesus. It's going to be a little teaching tonight because I want to make sure somebody get it tonight. And I'm a preacher now. I get ready to preach. Y'all want to hear it tonight because God put his word in my spirit and for somebody tonight. The Bible declares in Exodus chapter 12, verse 23, for the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. And when he sees the blood upon the lintel or the cross piece, and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the sword to come unto your houses to smite you. Somebody say the blood.
The blood.
So God wants us men to cover our family under the blood. Look at everything. Cover your family under the blood.
Cover your family under the blood.
Cover your family under the blood. Cover your home under the blood. Cover your tongue under the blood. Cover your mind under the blood. Cover your body under the blood. Cover your finance under the blood. Cover your leaders under the blood. Because the devil wants to destroy you and your family.
My Lord. Amen.
Every day the enemy will try to attack your family. Three areas that the enemy is looking right now to attack. Number one is your family. Number two is your wealth or finance. And number three, your health. If he hasn't attacked one of all these three already, the Bible, look at Job here. The Bible declares in Job chapter 1, and the Lord said unto Satan, whence coming thou? He asked this question. Then Satan answered in the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, from walking up and down in the earth.
Come on.
to have your joy. He don't want you to have your peace. He is walking to destroy your family, your home.
Yes, he is.
The Bible declares in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8, be sober. Be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion. Walking about seeking whom he may devour or seeking whom he may destroy. The enemy wants to destroy your home. The enemy wants to destroy your family. The enemy wants to destroy your finance. The enemy wants to destroy your money. The Bible also declares in John chapter 10, verse 10. The thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. I come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. It's saying what the devil comes to do here, steal, kill, and destroy. That's what he wants.
My Lord.
He wants to steal, kill, and destroy. He said he wants you to put on the whole armor of God that you can stand against the wiles, the strategies, the tactics of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, but against powers and against rulers of this darkness, and spiritual wickedness in high places. The word wrestle is used of hand-to-hand combat. Emphasizes the personal and individual nature of the spiritual warfare waged against each local church and Christians. We do not wrestle against a fleshly thing. It's nothing in the flesh that we are wrestling against. It is a spiritual battle that we cannot see, that we are wrestling, that we are engaging everything with. You cannot see demons, but they are coming against your mind. If you have a spiritual eye, you can see all kind of things in the spiritual realm, and you are going to see the devil trying to attack your mind. If you look in the spirit realm, you can see all kind of things. Demons on people back, and it's determining them. Come on, somebody. And when you see the demon, if you look in the spirit realm, a demon trying to attack people's body, and cause them to have cancer, and all kind of issues in their life. I mean, if you see the spiritual world, you can see what's going on around you.
All right. My Lord, amen.
Oh, yeah. There are four levels of demonic attack. Okay. I'm going to explain it to you. I wish I had more time. Number one, principalities. Somebody say principalities. That means rulers. I don't have time to get into that detail. Number two, somebody say number two, powers. That means authority. Number three, rulers. That means world rulers. Number four, spiritual wickedness. Wicked spiritual being that is fallen angels, demons, and Satan himself. You have four levels.
Yes.
You have some demons that just own a regional. There's, you know, you have some local demons, and you have some demons that is territorial, and you have some demons that over states. You have some demons that over country. You have some demons that over, and you go to Iraq, you have strong demons, and I rank all these strong demons. Every area is different. Hello, somebody?
Amen.
You go to Sin City, it's a totally whole atmosphere in Orlando, state of Florida, amen? You have all kind of demons there, and I ain't got time to name, no. But it's all kind of demons in every location, in every region of the world that we are wrestling against that we don't know.
Mm-hmm. Mama.
So every day you are wrestling against a spiritual demon that you cannot see. The Bible also said in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 to 5. Let's turn there real quick. I want you to get this tonight. 2 Corinthians real quick. Verse 10, chapter 10.
Before try to do right, and it seems